God, we hope you understand that when we clap our hands, we show our love to you. This world is not our choice, so we lift our voice in total praise is to you, 'cause we need you more and more, more and more. We can't make it by ourselves, we need you, God, more and more, more and more. And we worship no one else. Now we raise our hands up high, high up to the sky. God, we truly honor you, and because of who you are, you're the greatest by far. Majesty belongs to you.
Let us prepare ourselves for worship. We rejoice today in worship as we give God praise, honor, and glory for being a God who continues to be faithful. Our history is filled with stories of how God's faithfulness has given strength and purpose to generations past. When we see God's faithfulness in action, it gives us hope for the future. Today we rejoice in knowing that God is faithful as we experience struggles, tragedies, circumstances, and situations. It is good to know that nothing in life can separate us from the love and faithfulness of God. This is our call to worship. Let us join together in the affirmation of faith. What do we believe? I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son of our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he arose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Amen.
Before service started, Pastor and I sang, I need thee every hour. Now I changed the words to, we need thee every hour. Because there's so much that's going on, we need God to intercede. We need the Holy Spirit to talk to us, to speak to us. And most of all, in my prayer today, I'm going to ask God to help our children, help our young sons and daughters. So, in my prayer, firstly, I need to thank God for allowing us to see another day and giving us the opportunity to praise him and thank him for all he's done through these difficult times. I pray, Father, for the souls who do not know you as their personal Savior. And most of all, Lord, I pray for our young sons and daughters in their 30s and under and above who are lost in this world of sin. So many don't believe in you or understand your place or purpose in their lives. So, Father, I pray for them. I pray that you answer their questions. For you said that the Holy Spirit would show us all truths. And these children, we, and not just them, Father, we need you. And we need to hear from you. I pray, Holy Spirit, that you speak to our hearts. For Satan has led us, Lord God, to believe that there is no God. That what God would cause this pandemic to happen. But Lord God, they need to also know that you have saved many of us. Yes, many have died and gone to be with you. But Lord God, You have saved us from dangers seen and unseen. We have been in places, Lord God, and around people who have had COVID. But Lord God, you have kept us safe, and we have to thank you for that and love you for all you have done. I also pray, Lord God, for our loved ones during this pandemic who have lost family members and friends, for there have been many, Father God. I pray that you give them peace during this season in their lives. I pray, Father, for our pastor, and I thank you, God, for sending us someone who leads and guides us, who tells us truths, who doesn't cover things up. We thank you, Father, for him being our shepherd. But Lord God, we need you. We need you every hour, Father. We need to know that you're there. We need to know that you love us. And I need you to touch all of those who don't know you, Father, who don't know you as I do. But help them, Lord God, to remember who you are. Help them to see what you have done for them in the past. Help them to know, Father, that you're the one who, in times of trouble, put food on their tables, a roof over their head, who gave them heat, Lord God, who's going to provide for them in the future as you have done for us in the past. You have provided protection. You have provided love. You have provided friends when there were no friends. You have provided for us in every area of our lives. And we just want to say thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord, for all you have done in our lives. Amen. Lord, keep.
Oh,
Let us prepare for the word of God. Father, I stretch my hands to thee. No other help I know. If thy withdraw thyself from me, O Lord, our God, where shall I go? Lord, once again, I'm in this sacred space, in this sacred moment to preach your divine word. Use me now as an instrument of your divine will so that I may preach a word of liberation, a word of transformation, and a word of empowerment for your people. Now, Lord, let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in thy sight. O Lord, you are my strength and you are my redeemer. And all the people of God said, amen. I ask you on this Lord's Day to journey with me to the book of 2 Samuel, the 11th chapter. The book of 2 Samuel, the 11th chapter. The book of 2 Samuel, the 11th chapter. We're going to use the whole chapter as this preaching moment, but yet for the scripture reading, we will skip around from verse to verse. I ask you, let's begin at verse 1, 2 Samuel, 11th chapter, beginning at verse 1. The word of God says, in the spring of the year, the time when kings go out to battle, David sent Joab with his officers and all Israel with him. They ravaged the Ammonites and besieged Rabbah, but David remained at Jerusalem. It happened late one afternoon when David rose from his couch and was walking about on the roof of the king's house, that he saw from the roof a woman bathing. The woman was very beautiful. David sent someone to inquire about the woman. It was reported, this is Bathsheba, daughter of Eliam, the wife of Uriah the Hittite. So David sent messengers to get her, and she came to him and he lay with her. Now she was purifying herself after her period. Then she returned to her house. The woman conceived and she sent and told David, I am pregnant. Let's skip down to verse 14. In the morning, David wrote a letter to Joab and sent it by the hand of Uriah. In the letter he wrote, set Uriah in front of the hardest fighting and then draw back from him so that he may be struck down and die. And then let's go to verse 26. When the wife of Uriah heard that her husband was dead, she made lamentation for him. When the morning was over, David sent and brought her to his house, and she became his wife and bore him a son. But the thing that David had done displeased the Lord. For a little while on this Lord's Day, we want to preach from the thought, power, sex, and lies. Power, sex, and lies. Amid the season of Lent, we celebrate women. March is considered Women's History Month. But I enjoy calling it Women's Empowerment Month. Just like I believe that we should celebrate Black history 365 days a year, I also believe that the contributions women make to our world and in our lives should be a year-round celebration. And while we are celebrating their accomplishments, we should also be empowering them to move beyond the misogynistic, oppressive, marginalizing and life-hindering attitude of those who would like to view women as second-class citizens or objects that should be sexually desired or abused. We continue to see women speaking up and coming out as a means of fighting against abuse and injustice, letting the world know that they will not be silenced because they have God-given worth and value. As a society, it seems we are bombarded with television shows that center on power, sex, and lies. I wonder if these shows are mirror images of our current society, a society that seems to focus on using power, privilege, and authority as a means of getting what they want or what certain individuals want, regardless of the consequences or whom it might hurt in the process. A society that allows those with power, wealth, and fame to abuse the system or use the system to their advantage. A society that thinks it's okay to pay lower salaries to women or people of color. A society that seems to center everything around sex because we have been conditioned as a society to believe sex sells. Sex is used in the selling of merchandise in commercials. It is the primary moneymaker in the entertainment industry. From the music videos we listen to the videos and movies we watch. The abuse of sex in our society has generated a culture of its own, especially as it creates divisions within human relationships. When divisions are created, we then use lies and deceit to cover up the abuse of power and sex. In the 2016 presidential election, the theme of power, sex, and lies became a topic that hit center stage. And currently, the governor of New York is being investigated. From the church to the workplace, from our families to our communities, power, sex, and lies have a systematic way of destroying the fabric that holds us and binds us together as a community and as God's greatest creation. I know as a church community, we do not deal with the issue of sex very well, even though it is a problem in our society, and far too often the church is silent. Even when it comes to sexual abuse and exploitation, the church is silent. Even when it affects the women in our families and even in our churches, the church is silent. Even though the Bible presents many stories of sexual abuse, rape, and incest to help us navigate the deep waters of sexual abuse and exploitation, the church is still silent. However, if the church is to be transformative, if the church is to be empowering, if the church is to be liberating, if the church is to be relevant, if the church is to be all that God created the church to be, and if the church is to be the community of faith that Jesus the Christ died for, the church cannot remain silent. Many of us are familiar with the David and Bathsheba story from the biblical narrative found in 2 Samuel, the 11th chapter. In the telling of the story of David and Bathsheba, it seems it is always told from David's perspective, a perspective of power, authority, and privilege. Even the biblical writers and many of the biblical commentaries tell it from David's perspective, or better yet, from a male perspective. Therefore, we never seem to hear Bathsheba's side of the story, a story of how the voices of the oppressed and the marginalized are silenced by a system that seems to maintain the status quo, that wants to keep people in their place, that place where they use power, privilege, misogyny, and patriarchy to maintain the status quo. When I analyze the story of David and Bathsheba, I see it from a perspective or from the premise of how God's grace, mercy, and love can work through imperfect people, imperfect relationships, and tragedy. The story reminds us that God is constantly at work. Even when things are at their worst, God is working. God is working in and working through the most troubling, tragic, and devastating times, situations, circumstances, and issues that confront us on this journey called life. God is working for justice, truth, and wholeness. The text opens with David being in Jerusalem. And at the springtime of the year, the writer tells us and lets us know that at this time of the year, kings would go out to battle. However, David chooses not to go out to battle, but sends Joab and the army to fight the Ammonites. We also connect springtime with that season of the year when birds are chirping and flowers are blooming. Some say it is a time when love is in the air. It is a time when sexual passions and desires begin to rise. As King David is at home in Jerusalem in the springtime, as his army is in battle, he awakens from an afternoon nap, walks about on his rooftop, and sees the beautiful Bathsheba bathing. The text does not say she was naked, because in Jewish culture, public nudity was considered shameful. The text does not state or even suggest that Bathsheba was doing anything wrong or sexually provocative. She was taking care of her personal hygiene. However, many interpreters of the text have turned Bathsheba into a woman who sexually entices the divinely chosen king. Many interpreters of the text accuse her of bathing sexually because if David, a man after God's own heart, David, our biblical hero, David, the king of Israel, should sin, It is because the woman made him do it. She must have deliberately enticed him. She must have been a gold digger, or she dazzled and trapped him by bathing sexually on the rooftop to be seen by the king. Because Bathsheba has no voice, she is unjustly viewed as a seducer, an enticer, and an adulterer. The comedian, actor, and singer Jamie Foxx said it like this: "It ain't my fault. You are the one that wore that black dress." The reality is that many people need somebody to blame for our mess ups and our dirt. It is a male fantasy to think that women are being seductive when in fact they are just being who they are, and some men exploit the situation. In our male-dominated society, we buy into the notion that women are responsible for men abusing them, violating them, or sexually exploiting them. Too often, women are blamed for the abuse that happens to them. They are forced to cope with the guilt and the shame of the abuse, the rape, and the exploitation. However, before we get it twisted, women can also be sexual exploiters, violators, and abusers. Sometimes they use this to trap men. But yet, as we look at the text does not say that Bathsheba saw David, but it does state that David saw Bathsheba. Could it be possible that David's gaze was not accidental, but that he was out looking for a sexual encounter? David was on the rooftop creeping, and that Bathsheba was just in the wrong place at the wrong time? Could it be that David was caught up in the culture's emphasis on sex and sexuality, that he became consumed with sexual thoughts? If we are not careful, we can become bamboozled by society into thinking that sex is not a gift from God, but is a desire that must be satisfied. We can get to the place where sex and the abuse of power can become addictive. When many of us think of addiction, we seem to limit it to chemical or substance addiction, such as alcohol or drugs. However, the truth of the matter is that work, food, gambling, exercise, violence, computers, phones, the abuse of power, and sex can be addictions. Usually, addictions are our ways of coping with the stresses of life, and sex and the abuse of power can become the drug of choice. Whether we are male or female, there are times we use sex as a coping mechanism to cover up the pain in our lives. That there are those men who will say anything, promise anything, and buy almost anything just for sex. Then there are those women who use sex as a way of attempting to find love or use it to get what they want. In some cases, women use sex to find love, and men use the idea of love to find sex. Therefore, it is important that we have healthy sexual conversations in the church. Let me say that again. It is important. It is imperative that we have healthy sexual conversations in the church to help men and women, especially single men and women, know that they have intrinsic worth and value. God created us with value and worth. Therefore, we should not sell ourselves short or give away our most precious gift at a discount price. The text says that David inquires about the woman he sees bathing and is told that she is Bathsheba, the daughter of Eliam and the wife of Uriah the Hittite. The text identifies her as a person with a name. She is Bathsheba. She is also someone's daughter, Eliam, and the wife of Uriah, whose name in Hebrew means "the Lord is my light." I will suggest that David does not see Bathsheba as a person, but he sees her as an object. David's gaze of Bathsheba dehumanizes her and takes away her personhood. Because David does not value her as a person, he sins for her. It's all about what David wants, and he has no concern for Bathsheba's feelings. Can you imagine what Bathsheba is going through when the king's messengers and armed guards come to her house? Remember, her husband Uriah is in battle against the Ammonites. These messengers could be coming to inform her that her husband is dead. Can you imagine the emotional turmoil Bathsheba must be feeling as she is being escorted to the king's palace? Thoughts of the worst kind running through her head. Her heart is pounding. Her feet are heavy. Her emotions and anxieties are running high. And she is possibly crying, wondering what message the king has for her. When she arrives at the palace, possibly crying and hysterical, King David takes advantage of her. David victimizes her. David abuses her. David violates her. David rapes her. David takes from her her most precious and prized possession. There are those who say that she could have resisted. She could have run away, or she could have just said no. However, resistance is not an option for Bathsheba. David is the king of all Israel. He has the power to put her to death with just a look. At this point, Bathsheba is not a person. She is an object. She is a thing to David. Bathsheba has become a victim of David's power, authority, and sexual desire. David was not looking for a wife. He already had a few of those. David was looking for a quickie. David was looking for a hookup. David was looking for a hit it and quit it. He was looking for a jump off. David used his power and authority for sexual gratification. Power is defined as the possession of control, authority, or influence one has over others. Power is the ability to get what one wants by any means necessary. There is nothing wrong with having power, but the issue is how we use the power that we have. Do we use it for selfish gain, or do we use it as a means of helping others be the best that they can be? From government officials to workplace supervisors to church leaders, and even in our families, we too often use our power and authority as a means of manipulation and exploitation. When the words, "you know who I am," are used, it is usually in relationship to a power move. David was pleased to receive the kingdom as a gift from God, but now as king, he uses his God-given power and authority to take what he wants. David violates his covenant responsibility as king. David violates his responsibility as a member of God's creation. David had the responsibility to protect and nurture those under his authority, but he violates his solemn oath and abuses his power. I wonder what Bathsheba felt after being victimized by the beloved king of Israel, because everyone in the kingdom loved David. The people trusted David. Everyone praised and honored King David. I wonder what was going through Bathsheba's mind as she is walking back to her home. Did she feel it was her fault? What would she tell Uriah, her husband, if he found out? I am sure she felt shame and guilt, even though there was nothing she could have done to prevent what happened to her. Sexual abuse is inherently shaming. Anytime one person treats another as an object to gratify one's sexual needs rather than a person that is worthy of honor and respect, a shaming takes place. Even today, we shame Bathsheba by calling her an adulteress when she had no power to resist David's actions and advances. She should not be faulted for being beautiful. The sin that was committed is on David and on David alone. The only words we hear from Bathsheba in this narrative is when she sends David a message that she is pregnant. After David gets the news, he does not speak with Bathsheba. He does not console her. He does not consult her. He does not own up to what he has done. However, David decides to take matters into his own hands by using deception and lies to cover up his sin. David sends a message to Joab to send Uriah, Bathsheba's husband, home. David's plan is to have Uriah come home, and after being away from his beautiful wife for an extended period of time, will go to his home and have sexual relationships with her to cover up the pregnancy. However, Uriah the Hittite does not go home, but sleeps outside with the servants, not once, but three times. The story shows that Uriah the Hittite, Uriah the one with Gentile ancestry, Uriah the one that many Israelites would look down upon with disgust, was more honorable than the beloved king of Israel. Because Uriah did not fall for the okey-doke, and so David found himself stuck like Chuck. David had to come up with a new plan, a new lie, which was to have Uriah killed in battle. Therefore, we see David again using his authority, power, and selfish desires to destroy a life. This time, it was in having Uriah, Bathsheba's husband, killed. After Uriah is killed, David marries Bathsheba, not because he wants to, but to cover up the rape and pregnancy. David's desire was to maintain his good king persona by any means necessary. I heard someone call the cover up a satisfaction. A satisfaction is when the feeling of satisfaction is completely fiction or false. David felt that he had gotten away with something, but we all know that what is done in the dark will surely come to the light. Just because it seems we are getting by does not know that we are getting away. It does not mean we're getting away. The truth of the cover-up is that David could not have done it without the cooperation of others. The abuse that takes place cannot be covered up without help. Somebody saw it, somebody heard it, and somebody suspected it. But too often people choose not to get involved for various reasons. Too often the people that know the truth stay silent. The horrifying reality of the story is that David was known as a good man, a man after God's own heart. The world is filled with good people, male and female, that abuse their power, privilege, and authority, that use sex and tell lies. It happens in schools, it happens in the workplace, it happens in government, and even in the church. Our families and our communities are home to those who have been victims of good people. And it's more than you might think. The thing I like about the story is that Bathsheba is a survivor. She is a woman of strength. She is a woman of courage. She is a woman of purpose. She is a woman who did not allow the tragedy of her past to hinder her from a dynamic future. She became the first queen mother of Israel. Even though her first son with David died, God vindicated her and blessed her with a second son named Solomon, and who became the wise king after David. Abuse, grief, tragedy, and loss are difficult life events, and they are not easy to overcome. However, there are truths and strategies we can use to help us be survivors and overcomers. Being an overcomer is a task that lasts a lifetime. The tragedy might have happened in a moment, but it may take a lifetime to overcome. If you have been abused sexually or physically, go get some professional counseling. I know as African Americans, we do not like professional counseling, but there are times we need someone to help us navigate the shock, the pain, the heartache, the bargaining, the depression, the anger, and the acceptance that comes with a tragic incident. We also must recognize and understand that in time and with the right help, our stories become our medicine. Our stories become the testimony that we made in it. And if we can make it, the next person can make it also. It's not about forgetting what happened, but it's about overcoming and becoming stronger through it. In the midst of the tragedy, in the midst of the hurt, in the midst of the guilt, in the midst of the shame, we must know and never forget that God cares about us. We must never forget that God cares about what we're experiencing. God cares about our struggles. God cares about our midnight tears. And God cares about what we are going through. Therefore, I love singing that hymn that says, "Be not dismayed, whatever betide. Know that God will take care of you. Beneath God's wings of love abide. God will take care of you. No matter what may be the test, God will take care of you. Lean weary one upon God's chest. God will take care of you. God will take care of you. through every day, over all the way. God will take care of you. God will take care of each of us. God will take care of us by giving us the strength to make it some way and somehow through whatever we're going through. God will take care of us by giving us the courage to face the enemies or to face the destruction that happens in our life and the tragedies, because we must realize that the tragedies that happen to us will not destroy us, because God will give us the strength to make it. God will take care of us through God's divine presence to help us in the fight. Regardless of the situations, regardless of the issues, regardless of the problems, regardless of the circumstances, know that God is with us through it all. Therefore, beloved, no matter what we are going through, don't throw in the towel, don't quit, don't think you're less than, but know that God will be with us in the fight and in the struggle. We must do whatever it takes to survive and overcome. This is our word for today. To God be the glory.
Never would have made it. Never could have made it without you. I would have lost it all. But now I see how you were there for me, and I can say, never would have made it. Never could have made it without you. I would have lost it all. But now I see how you were there for me, and I can say, I'm stronger, I'm wiser, I'm better, much better. When I look back over all you brought me through, I can see that you are the one I held on to, and I never,
never would have made it.
God, We all have difficulties and situations that we go through. All of us have experienced people abusing their power, people taking advantage of us, people exploiting who we are and victimizing us and abusing us in some way, shape, form, or fashion. But in the midst of it all, we must value who we are. We must know that we have intrinsic worth, that God loves us unconditionally. Know that no matter what has happened, that God loves you, that God cares about what has happened to you. So as I offer this invitation today, I offer the invitation to ask you that if you have gone through a moment of exploitation, a moment of abuse, a moment of victimization, get professional help. God created those persons out there to help us navigate these moments so that we can be whole. And if you are an abuser, also get some help. There's help available for you too. God loves each of us, and God wants us to be strong. God wants us to be able to be all that God created us to be. And then if you have not accepted Jesus as Lord and Savior, today is a good day to give your life to Christ and allow your life to take a different path toward wholeness, toward salvation, toward eternal life. And then just maybe because you think that what you've done or what has happened to you has separated you from God, the Bible says nothing in this life, nothing in heaven and nothing below can separate us from the love of God. God loves us unconditional. So all you have to do is talk to God. Say, Lord, here I am, broken, bruised, abused, victimized, but Lord, here I am, just me. And God welcomes you. God loves you. God will come for you because God loves you that much. This is our invitation for today. To God be the glory. Let us receive the benediction. And now may the grace of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the sweet communion of the Holy Spirit rest, rule, and abide in each and everyone's life. And all of God's children said, amen. As I come before you today, I know that there's a lot of things going on in our world. We're still dealing with the COVID-19 virus pandemic. All those who are able to get vaccinations, I ask you to please get your vaccination. I was able to get mine last week, and I thank God for that. And so I ask you to use whatever resources that you have available to you. And I ask you to also help somebody else. Help somebody else be able to sign up and get vaccinated. That's what being a good community partner is all about. I thank you so very much for watching us on Facebook and YouTube and calling into our conference call line. And know that we here at Phillips are trying to do the best that we can to serve the people God has placed in our care. So I ask you to share our broadcast on Facebook, share it on YouTube, and let family and friends know of the great things that are going on here at Phillips Christian Methodist Episcopal Church. If you would like to give to this ministry, I ask that you go to our website, www.phillipscmechurch.org, and there you will find tabs for PayPal and Givelify. But if you would like to mail your gift in, you can mail it to Phillips CME Church, P.O. Box 3917, Huntsville, Alabama, 35810. And I ask you and know that the members of Phillips CME Church, I want to let you know that there will be a Call Church conference on Thursday, March 18th at 6:30. A Call Church conference on March 18th at 6:30, something very important that we must discuss. But I thank you so very much for all that you're doing. Know that we at Phillips, that we love you. Why? Because we are Phillips. Yeah. To God be the glory.
On my way home.
On my way home.
On my way home.
Yeah.
On my way home.
On my way home.
Oh, yes, I am. Come on, Jesus.
Please,
Lord.
Like
you said you would. You know what? I have to cry sometimes.
Oh, my.
time.
Yeah.
Sometimes singing with tears in my eyes.
Well,
I'm waiting on you. Just one more thing I want to say, y'all. No matter. I get mistreated sometimes. I get mistreated sometimes. What I tell the Lord, fix it, Jesus.
Fix it,
Jesus. Fix it, Jesus.
Fix it,
Jesus. Fix it, Jesus.
Fix
my heart.
Fix
my mind. Do it for me right now. I know you're able. You got all power in the palm of your hand. Anybody else know that God will fix it? Does anybody know that God will fix it? Let me have it pop my hands. Let me have it pop my hands. If anybody be sick, if anybody be fix it, oh, oh, oh. He fixed it for me, y'all. He fixed it for my mother. He fixed it for my father. I feel like dancing. I feel like dancing. I feel